Nigerians in the diaspora have called on the National Assembly to review the rejection of a bill on diaspora voting. According to them, the rejection of the bill for an act to alter the provisions of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1999, to provide for diaspora voting and for related matters by the National Assembly had set back the hands of Nigeria's democracy clock. Collins Nweke, the board chairman emeritus of Nigerians in the Diaspora Organization and counselor for societal affairs at Ostend City Council in Belgium, he joins us now to speak on why Nigerians in the diaspora should not be disenfranchised. Good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining the program this afternoon. I want to start with asking you about your reception of this bill. First of all, you have described it as the way of democracy being us taking our steps, a couple of steps back in Nigeria's democracy. Please, can you explain to us the importance of the Nigerians in the diaspora, especially for our democracy here at home?
Thank you very much for having me. First and foremost, the Nigerians in diaspora are Nigerians. That is in the first instance. And so, being Nigerians, they should not be disenfranchised, and their physical location should not be an excuse for them not to participate in choosing who leads Nigeria. That's number one. Number two, we have seen globally that Nigerians in diaspora are making very significant inroads in different countries of the world where they reside. They continue to be an asset to Nigeria, not only in terms of remittances, you know, capital inflow into Nigeria, but also in terms of actually being the permanent representatives of Nigeria throughout the world, where they represent Nigeria very, very excellently. And we have also seen from what is happening, examples from other parts of the world. Take, for example, the Israeli diaspora, the Irish diaspora, just to name but few, and how they have been able to galvanize support for their home countries, and through their diaspora experience are able to impact positively in the accelerated development of their country. They couldn't have done that if their countries disenfranchised them. And so it is actually very, very obnoxious for the legislators in Nigeria to disenfranchise the Nigerian diaspora. That is actually taking a few steps backwards, because incrementally from 1999, when President Olusegun Obasanjo muted the idea of active engagement with the Nigerian diaspora, they have continued to make progress to the point that where we are now is that there is a commission responsible for the diaspora, the NITCOM, Nigerians in Diaspora Commission. Although that commission has not been fully constituted in terms of having a board, more than 2 years, going to 3 years after it was founded, it is supposed to actually galvanize support, knowing that this is not a party political affair, because you need two-thirds of the Nigerian legislators to actually pass the law. So it is unacceptable to concentrate efforts on only one session of the politics of Nigeria, the APC in this case, and refusing to work across the board to be able to get Nigerians, the legislators especially, across the board to be able to support this bill. So I think the first thing that needs to be done now is to do a post-mortem. Now, I do not discountenance importance of the effort that is being made to, retable the bill and all of that. But I believe that it's probably going to be a Herculean task. I think what needs to be done now is to do a very thorough post-mortem to understand exactly how we got to where we are now, and then, begin to mobilize for, this bill to pass as speedily as possible.
All right, Mr. Nweke, some would say that the executive, which actually established through an act of the National Assembly in Nigeria in Diaspora Commission, are simply on a different wavelength with the legislatures. in terms of how they see and perceive Nigerians in the diaspora. Would you say this is very true?
To some extent, yes, it is true. But you see, this is about management of expectations. And I'd like to tell you one thing. And that is the part that the leadership of the National Assembly, both the Senate and the House of Representatives, individually, because they come out here, you know, we are with them. Initially, yes, it took some time to convince them about the sense of, you know, Nigerians in diaspora being able to vote in Nigerian election. But we have long moved away from, you know, trying to convince them. So it now became a matter of when it should happen, not if it should happen. So, yes, preaching to the leadership of the Nigerian, legislative arm, is actually preaching to the converts because they are converted. Check them, you know, public statements. Even INEC itself, is sold to the idea. So they are all sold to the idea. But I believe that the, NITCOM has not actually lived up to its bidding. They have actually mismanaged, very, very woefully mismanaged this whole process. Instead of galvanizing the diaspora, they are actually spending more time polarizing the diaspora, sowing division amongst them that even the diaspora themselves are not quite speaking in one voice in terms of using the instrument, the policy instrument that government established, which is the Nigerians in Diaspora Organization, to actually facilitate the work of NITCOM. Rather, NITCOM is, you know, actually setting up some mushroom groups to, you know, dance to its tune, abandoning the government policy. So those are working at cross purposes, and I believe it is now time to get all of that, out of the way and begin to, work with all our noses facing in one direction.
So what then is the way forward? How should NITCOM go about it when eventually the bill is represented to the National Assembly?
First and foremost, NITCOM has got to do what it has to do to get its board fully constituted. At the moment, what we have is a NITCOM that is run and managed by one individual, which is the chairman. Now, that is actually against the establishment bill that led to the NITCOM Act. Now, once the board is constituted, I believe then that you have the manpower that is required to then begin to galvanize different groups to build momentum and then get the two-thirds majority that is needed. That is one, and I believe that if you talk to NITCOM, they will tell you that, well, it is the president that constitutes the board of NITCOM. Yes, we know that we're not that daft, but at the same time, NITCOM has a role to play, but perhaps the current chairman of NITCOM is happy with the situation as it is. That is why not enough is being done to get the board constituted. So that's on the one hand. On the other hand, the diaspora need to get their ass together in terms of actually ignoring all the side, the distractions that are coming and concentrate on galvanizing themselves and beginning to speak in one voice, because we do have groups within the diaspora, political groups, as a matter of fact, who want to take credit for the diaspora voting. And as they do that, they are not carrying as many as possible along. And then that leads to polarization. And then the legislators actually play into those polarization. The time now has come to put all of that away and begin to work purposefully.
Mr. Nweke, earlier on you had cited a couple of nations who had actually galvanized the socioeconomic power of their citizens abroad in the diaspora. What can we learn from them, specifically Israel and Greece, like you mentioned earlier?
Yes, indeed. What we can learn from them is that essentially, for you to reap the benefits that a diaspora brings to the table, you need to galvanize the diaspora, and the diaspora has to be a very active partner of government in national development. Nigeria is just not there yet. Now, Nigeria is there only halfway with the establishment of NICOM, which is a significant milestone. But then NICOM is actually a lame duck at this moment, because it cannot be that a commission that is actually expected to be fully constituted has only one board member. And so, as a matter of fact, they are limited in capacity to do what they have to do. So that capacity needs to be there for a start. And then active engagement with the diaspora body and other diaspora groups would have to then comment. This is what these other groups have done, so that they are active partners of government. And from that vantage position, they can then move forward and work in the interest of the country and not the interest of either the individual diaspora or the chairperson or board members of the commission.
Mr. Nweke, you've severally called out NITCOM and your failure to be able to push forward active policies and also take actions that should benefit those in diaspora. If your scorecard is this low, are you almost calling for the change of guard, literally, in NITCOM as we speak right now?
Not exactly. I'm not calling for the change of guard. And I want to make this very, very clear. The chairman of the Diaspora Commission was a good choice. I mean, the current one, she has a pedigree. If you check her track records in diaspora affairs, you can do nothing but applaud all of that. All I am saying is that she has got to realize that at this point in time, politics in leading a national commission has got to be put on one side, and she has to work across board. This is not an APC affair. This is a Nigeria affair. The moment she's able to do that or gotten to do that, I mean, she has to want to do that willingly, but if not willingly, then she has to be made to do that. And the moment that is done, I believe that things will begin to move, purposefully. So I'm not calling for a change of guard, but I'm calling for the guard that is in place now to work more purposefully than she has been seen to be doing.
Thank you so much for joining this discussion this afternoon, Colin Nweke. And we really, really hope that in the future something can be done about our citizens in the diaspora getting representation.